Welcome back to this week of renewable energy generation. In this video, we will discuss the theoretical potential of wind energy. In week 5, we will discuss wind energy technology and systems in great technical detail. This is the image most people will visualize when they think about wind energy. A large wind turbine with slowly rotating blades. But how much energy does this large turbine generate? And what is the generation limit of such a turbine? And what is the energy potential of the wind to begin with? To understand that, we need to understand the basics of how wind energy conversion technologies work. The main principle of a wind turbine is to convert the kinetic energy in the wind into usable electricity. Let's first take a look at a real-life installation before diving into the theory of wind energy. The country of Denmark is a worldwide leader when it comes to wind power. Denmark produces about 40% of their electricity demand with wind power alone. In 2015, they had a total installed capacity of 5 gigawatts, with which they produce 14.1 terawatt hours. This is about 0.04 terawatt hours per day. With a population of approximately 5.7 million people, the wind energy generated in Denmark is about 7 kilowatt hours per person per day, which is equal to 2.4 human energy units. We can again calculate a value expressed in kilowatt hours per watt of installed capacity. In this case, of Denmark, we just have to divide the 14.1 terawatt hours per year by the 5 gigawatt of installed capacity to get about 2.8 kilowatt hours per watt of installed capacity. If we divide it again by the hours in a year, we get a capacity factor of 0.32, or 32%. This we can now compare with the capacity factor of the example of hydroelectricity of around 70%. To conclude that wind energy produces less electricity per installed capacity unit than hydroelectricity. This is caused by daily and seasonal changes in the wind speeds and because a wind turbine does not operate at maximum power for low wind speeds. Now we will verify these numbers with some theoretical calculations of wind energy. Like mentioned before, we need to transform the kinetic energy in the wind into usable electric energy. However, not all of the kinetic energy in the wind can be turned into electricity. Energy extracted from the wind by the turbine at area A causes the wind speed to decline to a velocity V2, and the airflow behind the turbine will expand to an area as big as A2 in this case. This effect also takes place in front of the turbine. The area from which energy can be extracted with the original wind speed of V1 is only as large as area A1. So geometrically, there is a theoretical limit of 59.3% of the energy in the wind that can be converted into mechanical energy. This law was found by and named after Albert Betz, a German physicist. In practice, the maximum efficiency of commercial wind turbine is between 40 and 50% at ideal wind speeds. This is among other things due to inefficiencies in the power system and the gearbox. The efficiency also drops for low and high wind speeds. Let's get into some basic physics to make a rough estimate of the power in the wind. The general equation for kinetic energy is E kinetic equals half times the mass times the velocity squared. The mass of the wind can be expressed in terms of a mass flow per unit of time. We can then equate the following E kinetic per unit of time equal half times the mass flow per unit of time times the velocity of the wind squared. Energy per unit time is effectively the kinetic power of the wind. If the wind velocity is given for a certain height or region, all we need to know is to calculate the mass flow of the wind. For this, we need to define a surface area through which the wind flows. This is represented by the frontal surface area of the wind turbine. The equation for the mass flow of the wind is as follows. The mass flow equals the frontal area of the wind turbine multiplied by the density of air times the velocity of the air. We should get a number expressed in the unit kilograms per second. When we check our units, we see that the surface is expressed in meter squared multiplied by the density in kilogram per meter cubed, finally multiplied by the velocity meter per second, will result indeed in the unit kilogram per second. We now put this mass flow back into the equation for the wind power. This results in the equation, the power of wind equals half times the density of the air times frontal surface area times the velocity of the air times the velocity of the air squared, which effectively the velocity of the air to the power of 3. This is the power available in the wind, which still has to be multiplied by the power coefficients. This power coefficient defines the efficiency of a certain wind turbine and is dependent on the wind speed. There is a great variety of wind turbines nowadays. The height of the towers can go up to 150 meters, while the rotor diameter can be as large as 150 meters. Let's use the equations for a typical wind turbine. We will take the Enercon E126 wind turbine as an example. It has a rotor diameter of 126 meters and a power coefficient of 0.483, 48%, at a wind speed of 10 meters per second. The frontal surface area will now be the area is P times the diameter half squared, which is around 12,469 square meters. The density of air is known, so the only thing missing is the wind speed, which is highly dependent on the location. We will assume the 10 meters per second as an average wind speed at the location or Enercon turbine is placed. Now, the power in the wind is P wind is half times the 1.2 kilogram per cubic meters times the 12,000 square meters area times the 10 to the power 3 meters per second to the power 3. This will result in a potential power in the wind of approximately 7.7 megawatts. However, this is not yet the power that can be extracted by the turbine. The power of the turbine is the power available in the wind multiplied by the power coefficient, in this case 7.7 megawatt times 0.48, which is equal to 3.7 megawatts. This is very close to the actual value of 3.75 megawatts in the data sheet of the Enercon wind turbine. With this simple estimation we just made, you're now able to make a back of the envelope calculation about the wind energy potential in your region. All you really need is the data on the average wind speed and an assumed size of a wind turbine. Know that a more accurate calculation will have a higher complexity than presented here, and this will be discussed in week 5. Let's also look at the surface power density of wind energy per land area. Wind turbines can't be placed too close to each other because they will steal each other's wind energy. Research has found that the surface power density of land-based wind energy, average over 24 hours of an entire day, is about 2 watt per square meters, resulting from the spacing of the wind turbines as well as the availability of less wind inland. An offshore wind park will result in a higher power density in the order of 3 watts per square meters. Know that this heavily depends on the typical wind speeds at the location of the wind park. To get an average energy density in kilowatt hour per square meter per year, we just have to multiply the surface power density with the hours in a year and divide by 1000. In this case, it's 70.5. Another factor we mentioned in the previous video was the CO2 footprint per kilowatt hour of hydro-generated energy. In this case of wind energy, the average footprint of the entire lifetime of a wind turbine is 11 grams CO2 per kilowatt hour for onshore wind and 12 grams for offshore projects. As you can imagine, the height and surroundings of a wind turbine greatly influence the wind speed they are exposed to. The wind speed will be higher if both the landscape is as flat as possible without any obstacles and the hub of the turbine is higher. Additionally, if you are closer to the coast of a country, you will receive more wind. Finally, let's take a quick look again into the global status of wind energy. In 2012, the global installed capacity was 283 gigawatts, producing 521 terawatt hours of electricity. This was about 2.3% of the global electricity demand and about 10% of all renewable electricity. We can also express the production of wind energy in our own units. If you divide it by the global population of 7.4 billion people and days in a year, we get 0.19 kilowatt hours per person per day, which is a little bit more than 0.07 human unit we introduced last week. Wind power can provide multiple times the world's need for energy. Try to do some calculations on the wind potential in your region and the world with the following exercises on our edX platform. And see you in the next blog.